most likely you could hear me without this microphone, but it makes everyone's life easier. So, I was one of the two producers on Young Justice and one of the writers on the show. I also did a little bit of voice acting on the show. I played the civics teacher, Lucas Carr. Really, the most important character on the show. So I'm just going to do a quick intro of everybody on the panel and just say what they did on the show. They've all done a lot of other great stuff, and feel free to ask them about that. So next to me is Brent Spiner. Brent played the Joker. Next to Brent is Lolita, Ritmanis, Kris Carter, and Michael McCuistion. These are dynamic music partners. They did all the music for the... next to Michael is Cameron Bowen, who played the Tim Drake Robin, and he also played the Toy Man. Cameron is Eric Lopez, who played Jaime Reyes, the Blue Beetle. And he was also the Scarab. Next to Eric is, hold your applause because this is a long list, Vanessa Marshall, who played Amanda Spence, Black Canary, Dinah Lance, Ida Berkowitz, Noor Harjavti, Firebrand, and Red Inferno. Next to Vanessa is Andrew Robinson, another writer on the show. He wrote the episodes Drop Zone, Targets, and Disordered. Next to Andrew is Stephanie Lemelin, who played Artemis, Tigress, Artemis Croc, Catherine Colbert, and the Justice League computer. Next to Stephanie is J.C. Spisak, who played Wally West, Kid Flash. And last but not least, Christopher Jones was the artist on the Young Justice comic book. Bumblebee and many, many other characters sends her apologies. She was going to come to, but she got in a car accident today. She's okay. She's a little sore, but she's okay. So she sends her regrets. She would very much have liked to have been here. Although I'm not sure we have room for a 13-foot chair.
You know what we should do? That was an awesome reaction. They're all, at the same time. We should send that to her. You know?
We'll all be on the internet. So,
exactly.
We have prepared absolutely nothing for this panel. So really what we have here is a Q&A, so we're looking for some Qs so we can bullshit some A's. So who's got the first question? Right here.
How can we get, do you guys have a number that we could start contacting to start petitioning for Young Justice?
Yeah, no, we really, really don't. There isn't anyone up on the stage, and plus a lot of other people who obviously would love to see Young Justice come back. It's, of course, not up to any of us. If it were, we'd still be making it now. The best thing you can do really is to vote with your wallets. I know that's crass, but it's the truth. You know, if you buy Young Justice trade paperbacks, you buy the DVDs, you buy the soundtrack.
5,000 of them.
Right. And really spread the word. You know, make sure that everyone you know has seen the show, has watched the show. Make sure they love the show. Don't let them not like it.
Yeah.
And get them all to buy stuff too. And you know, if Warner Brothers, Cartoon Network, DC Comics all feel there's money to be made on the show, they'll want to make more. But they have to really feel there's like a lot of money to be made on the show. And so that means that really that's the best way to convince them. Otherwise, you know, it never hurts to, petitions are fine. I don't know how much good they do, but it doesn't hurt. And respectful correspondence with those three companies.
Such as, you know, cosplay picketing outside of Cartoon Network.
Respectful
cosplay picketing.
You can hold the telephone.
It's also good. You know, any message sent that is cursing them out or blaming them and stuff like that, they tend to sort of just throw those away or delete them without reading them or paying attention to them. But if they're respectful, then, you know, it'll have a much greater effect. Anyone else? Yeah, back there.
This is for Spider.
Hello? Yes.
First of all, have you ever considered voicing the Joker in any other type of series? And second of all, how drastic of it was the change? Was the change from Data to the Joker?
You know, this is a two-part question, maybe a five-part answer. So you guys can split if you want. What was the first part? Yes, I have considered that. I've thought about it a lot, actually. Unfortunately, no producers have considered it. As a matter of fact, quite the opposite. It was a great experience doing it. I had no idea what I was doing. Fortunately, Greg was there to coach me through it. And, coaching, I mean, to tell me how to do it. To actually force me to do it.
Chains and guns were involved. It was ugly.
It was ugly, yeah. But it was a great experience, and I think we sort of, I mean, what a great bunch of people who played the Joker in the past. I mean, actually, I have a story. Can I tell a story? This is it's kind of ironic that I wound up playing the Joker. By the way, your B part of your question will be just as long. I have this sort of concert / one person ego fest that I do, and I tell this story in the show. Just so happens it works today. But when I was 3 years old,
get comfortable.
Then when I was four, when I was 3 years old, my mother took me to Hobby Airport in Houston, Texas, that's where I'm from, to pick up my grandmother. And Houston was a much smaller town then. It was, the airport was very small, and as we were standing there waiting, my mother looked down the terminal, and who did she see but Cesar Romero, who, as you know, played the Joker on the television series Batman. So she was beside herself, and she took out a piece of paper and a pencil, and she said, "Brent, you see that man over there? Go over to him and say, 'Excuse me, Mr. Romero, may I have your autograph?'" So I took the paper and the pencil, and I walked over, and I tugged on his pants leg, and I said, "Excuse me, Mr. Romero, may I have your autograph?" And he said, "Why, certainly, young man." And he took the paper and pencil and signed his name. Now, cut to 32 years later, I was at a rap party for the television series Falcon Crest. A friend of mine was on the show, and he invited me to come. And I'm standing there in the room, and I look across, who do I see? Cesar Romero, who was on that show. So I went over to him, and I said, "Excuse me, Mr. Romero. You probably don't remember me. But when I was 3 years old, I got your autograph at Houston Hobby Airport." And without a beat, he said, "Oh yeah, how's your mother?" Obviously very clever, but I mean, I was 3 years old. Chances are pretty good I was going to be with my mother. But in my narcissistic mind, I thought he remembered me. And I thought I hadn't changed that much. Anyway, B part of your question was?
How drastic was the change from Nate to Joker?
But then it was the same. Well, you know what? It was drastic, but there were steps along the way. You know, I mean, it didn't just go. I finished doing Data one day and started doing the Joker the next day. But in truth, it took me longer to get here today than it did to play the Joker. So, because I only did one episode. Remarkable as it was. All right, that's enough.
This is for anyone. How do you approach voice acting as opposed to stage acting? Is there a real difference?
Well,
less makeup?
That's true. Well, it's interesting you said stage acting, because for me, voice acting reminds me the most of stage acting as opposed to when I do TV or film. Because in TV and film, a lot of times the camera's so close to your face and you have to kind of take it down a notch. And I love when I get to do voice acting because you get to take it up a notch. And that's often what you get to do on stage. Not that there aren't moments, and not that a lot of people don't tell me, Stephanie, take it down a notch. On and off the stage. But that would be, for me, you know, those two are actually a little bit more similar. And something I love about voice acting that doesn't happen on stage, on film, on TV, you can play something so different than what the box you come in looks like. You know, I get to play a computer. Obviously, I don't look like one. And other such things. That would be my response, Jason.
I loved it. Anyone else is welcome. Well, I kind of think of it, to me, as an actor's greatest gift. Because not only are the scripts that you get to perform involved, especially if you're on a series, you know, unlike a movie or anything that you might do one time, the characters can evolve. But like Stephanie said, the only limit is your imagination. So anything that you can think of or sound like or dream up, you can become. And with the powers of people like Christopher Jones or the power of music, it all comes to life in a way that even when you close your eyes, you don't imagine it being that great. And that's one of the things I love about voice acting is, I mean, you can be on three shows at once, which you can't be on camera. And, you know, I've gotten to play so many different types of characters that I don't know if I would have that same leash, so to speak, on camera. But I just, you know, I love that about voice acting.
Addendum. Addendum. Also, when you're doing voice acting, I don't know, I don't want to swear, but it's like acting without the BS. I mean, you don't have to worry about going through makeup and hair, and
are
you don't
we
have
not
to.
Allowed to swear?
There's some real cute kids in the audience, right?
That's
never heard those words, I'm sure. So, but you know, it's just, you get to just act, purely act, and have fun, and connect, and something that I loved about doing Young Justice is that we were often in the room together, which isn't always the case on a lot of voice acting shows. You're in a booth by yourself. So it was really fun to be able to bounce off of a lot of these people. And like he said, to later see it on the screen, sometimes way too many months after we recorded, you know, you kind of forget what happened in that room and then you see it come to life. And it's such an exciting experience as opposed to, for instance, I'm on a show that's going to air on Monday, if you want to watch, on Sci-Fi Channel. But I shot that, thanks, whatevs, but I shot that right after I had a baby. And I'm really nervous to see it on Monday night, because I'm, like, a lot larger. And that never happened. I was never nervous to see myself in an animated show. Like judging yourself, you just get to enjoy it. Okay, that was my addendum.
Yeah.
It's called being human. I may or may not be playing a werewolf.
I was speaking with Christopher Jones about this earlier, but a lot of cartoons these days get one season or two season and then are canceled. I'm not bashing anything by saying this. But what does that say about the state of the industry where you can't necessarily get a cohesive story or the time that it takes to build it in the time that you're given? You set any question. If you'd like an easier one, I can supply.
I can feel the rage building.
Can't say that. Can't say that.
That's really more of a blood pressure issue. Greg will no doubt echo. I just came off of doing 2 years of a show that I created for The Hub called the Kaijudo.
Yes!
Rise of the Duel Masters. And what is true about kids' television in particular is that as even ratings aren't necessarily that important, most of these shows are designed to sell plastic.
Right.
And if they're selling a lot of plastic, they get renewed. Because they, you know.
He means merchandise in case.
Buy the toys, people, buy the toys.
If they're selling toys, they get renewed because, you know, the companies, you know, to put it bluntly, they see it as this is the commercial for the toy. No matter how good or complex or emotional the storytelling is, which we hope it is, I mean, we hope it makes you laugh. Kaijudo got two seasons. There was a toy line planned, and suddenly there was not. And there becomes an economic discussion when a toy company is funding a television show of why are we doing this? That the fan base can try to answer, but sometimes it's not enough. So I can't speak to why Young Justice got two seasons.
I think it's the same basic thing. I mean, you know, these shows are very expensive to produce. And even the cheapest ones are very expensive to produce. And for a lot of these companies, the justification for producing these shows isn't the ratings themselves, because the ratings are not significant. It's not like we're getting, you know, Big Bang Theory numbers or anything like that. And if we were, by the way, then the ratings would be high enough that they would say, okay, we don't care if we're selling toys because this is helping our network so much by drawing so many eyes to our station that, fine, we don't need the merchandising. But as much, you know, as popular as Young Justice was, and we had decent ratings for a kid show, we did, but they were never high enough that the ratings by themselves were enough to justify continuing the program. So that meant we were very toy dependent. And when Mattel, which has the master DC Comics license for all the DC heroes, canceled the Young Justice toy line and simultaneously decided, or not simultaneously, it was actually, they were months apart, but from your point of view, simultaneously decided that they weren't going to even do a Green Lantern animated series toy line. That meant that, you know, no Razor toys, no Kid Flash toys, and suddenly, economically, we're not a viable property anymore. Now, there are other ways to make the money. I mentioned, you know, we've got the Young Justice video game, Young Justice Legacy. There are other ways to show them, but it doesn't have the same kind of dollar signs attached, or they're just, the numbers aren't big enough, generally, without the toys. And when there is no toy line, there's almost no way to prove that the show is viable as a from a merchandising standpoint. And so it becomes a catch-22, and so they get canceled. And let's get onto a happier topic.
Just wanted to say how much I appreciate, I don't care about viability, I appreciate having series like Young Justice and Gargoyles.
Woo!
knows that that
this was Puck on Gargoyles.
Yes, I know. Puck is a kick-ass character. I love the way you voiced him. But I
Puck was sort of halfway between Data and the Joker, don't you?
but I have a kid, and those shows in particular are the kinds of shows that my son can enjoy as a child and I can enjoy as an adult. It's true family viewing. That may not sell a lot of toys, but it's something that we can watch that I can watch without wanting to claw my eyes out. And it's something he can, and it's something that he won't be bored by. So I love what you all do when you try to get a broad audience like that.
I love that you said that. Thank you.
I'm a toy collector. I think I speak for all toy collectors when I say that these guys need to take a little responsibility and step their game up with these toys.
Yeah.
Because when I was a kid, toys are way cooler than the ones that are coming out right now.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So write the letters and say, step your toy game up and maybe we'll buy the toys.
Justice Transformers.
Speaking for my gender, and as someone who collects Hot Toys action figures, chicks totally bought toys. But one of the things that was hardest with Young Justice is you have a show with an amazing female cast in it, which didn't always happen with and it wasn't just Lisa Mazza, it was CCH Pounder and Marina Sirtis and everyone, where if you love shows like that, write in and say, we want to buy our daughters these action figures. We will buy these action figures. We will kit bash these action figures.
Yes.
Because when you're doing it right and all you ever hear is how things are so wrong, I just wanted you guys to know that you did it right.
It's not going to do a Q&A anymore. Now it's just praise. Who's got the next praise?
Praise and adoration.
I wanted to ask, what was the impetus for moving the story 5 years ahead from season one?
That was all Spisak's idea.
Yeah, I was like, look, we got to get me and Artemis together. I don't know if anybody's seeing that, but I want to see it right now.
Brandon Vietti, who was the other producer on Young Justice and I, felt from the beginning, Brandon is amazing, smartest guy I know. It felt from the beginning that if this was going to be a show about coming of age and growing up, that we had to show characters grow up. And you can't do that over 6 consecutive months or even 1 consecutive year. And our first season ran in-universe from July 4th to December 31st. And our second season ran from December 31st to July 4th. It's just there were 5 years in between those December 31st. And we felt that to show our characters grow and change in a real significant way, we needed to do this time skip. Plus, selfishly, we wanted to bring in characters like the Tim Drake Robin and the Jaime Reyes Blue Beetle. We'll have fun with those characters as well. And that allowed us to do, I don't want to say generational, because it's not like, you know, teenagers 5 years apart are a whole different generation. Well, maybe, all right. But it did allow us to sort of, you know, play with this idea of there being seniors on the team and juniors on the team and sophomores and freshmen on the team, and having that mix throughout, so that in our second season, the mentors become the ones who were the protégés in the first season. And that seemed very important to, thematically, to the show that we were doing. And plus, it allowed us to get a lot more eye candy in there.
Quick, she asked about the music and how much time they got to do it. Were there spot sessions? What that process is like?
Well, working with Greg and Brandon was fantastic, because they already had an idea
I mean, Greg, well, but Greg, actually, you probably had the show written out for the next, you know, up to episode 100 or something. So there was a big arc already that was planned. But Brandon had an idea of what the sound he was looking for. And as far as how much time we have, we usually have anywhere from
a week to 2 weeks.
But it's a great process, especially the beginning is kind of intense just to find the right tone. And this series is so much, it's so kind of sound designy and cool. And then, you know, when the Justice League, the mentors show up, then it's more symphonic, but it's, the rest of it is kind of sound designy and cool. Whereas, you know, some of the other shows that we've done, we've had, you know, the fun kind of Teen Titans thing and Spectacular Spider-Man, which is more guitar driven. But you guys, what do you want to add to it?
Yeah, no, I think we approached the way we scored the scenes much differently in this series because it was much more about mood and texture than it was about, oh, here's your three-note theme or your four-note theme. And what we really tried to focus on was sort of just more of a raw emotional ambience, I guess. And so I just felt like we were focusing on pulse a lot, and whether there should be
pulse.
Yeah, pulse came up a lot. And how fast the pulse should be. And sometimes we would even have some kind of a pulsing thing happening in the music, even when we wouldn't normally do that on another show, just because it gave you this feeling of just impending uncomfortableness. And so we just kind of had a backwards approach to scoring the show, I would say, from what you would consider traditional, which I think gave it kind of a unique flavor. Yeah.
And I think what we carry over in more traditional scoring is we always collaborate. It's very important for us as the storytellers to work with the storytellers that tell a story through music, what's happening on screen, maybe what's not on screen, but to help propel the story forward.
One little thing to add, because we don't get to hang out with you guys very much, we're at the very end, so when we get the picture, we have the dialogue, and there's no sound effects, so things blow up, and oh, we just love it, because, you know, we're not hearing anything blow up, which means you'll be able to hear our music when we write it. But their voices are like instruments to us, so I'm listening, and it's like, oh my God, Artemis is talking. I don't even, you know, I don't even care what, I mean, you're beautiful, but it's like I hear your voice, and I start thinking, ooh, here's going to be the cool little thing that I'm going to do while she's talking. So it's very inspirational to actually meet these people for us. So
yeah, everything
us
matters.
Too, so much. I love
no, but everything matters. Like if you in your performance, you know, they decide whatever takes that they like of your performances, and that's great. And then we get it. But when we're writing the music, we hear it over and over and over and over as we're building the music for the scene.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if there's some little crack in their voice, we're like, oh my God, that's
souvenir,
not your voice.
Souvenir, souvenir.
You know, work that out. And so everything becomes very, very important that you guys have done, whether you know it or not, and it influences our approach greatly. So, thanks.
Cool. That's exactly how I approach the Joker. The raw emotional ambiance.
And our secondary benefit. If I asked really nicely, would you do a little Justice League improv for us?
I think Stephanie said she can do improv, just not on the spur of the moment.
Improv.
That was the joke.
We do have letters here. We need the letters.
Right. Improv writing was never one of the studios.
I'm happy to do it, but
just do a little sample of your voice in your character.
Oh my goodness.
Hi, I'm Professor Carr.
Professor Carr, 0, 1, 7.
Oh, you rock, babe.
I don't really remember. I can do a little puck for you, maybe. I don't remember that either. Could you improv some music for it? Do, do, do.
Berkowitz? I don't even remember that.
Ida Berkowitz, she was the elderly Chicago landlord.
board where
oh, yeah,
Samantha,
she was really grouchy.
And she's very Jewish.
A cameo. Very good.
Any relation to David Berkowitz?
Hey, Robin, have you seen Impulse? He ate all my Frosted Flakes.
I could never get that line. I said it wrong, and they. What is it again? Tor.
I don't know what you said.
Tourist or tarist or something. I don't know.
What about when we spent like 20 minutes on you saying no unnecessary risks to the squad?
That's a hard one. That's a tongue twister. That's a lot of S's. I just want Nightwing to like me.
Doesn't need you, dude. He's got Batman.
Alright, this is just a general question. Answer whoever feels like it. I'd say in both the show and the comics, the envelope was pushed a little bit in terms of content. Was there ever a moment where you just went, we're not going to get away with this?
Yeah, her line.
We did, though.
We did get away with it, yeah.
I'd say it.
No, now what? I admired Superman's thing.
It was out your weapons. You felt.
Oh, I felt naked. That one.
What?
Yes. But I didn't have my bow.
Right, you didn't have your bow and you felt naked, but.
Not in a fun way.
Then when we lost our memories, and she goes, you know, who put me in this? And I go, I am not judging that with a 10-foot. You know, yeah, we always got close.
But actually, on the comic book, Kris and I got we had this scene in the comic book. You want to take this one?
Well, are we thinking the Captain Adam story, or which one are you thinking?
No,
that one.
Queen Bee. Queen Bee.
Yeah. The last six issues of the comic were set, about like a month before the beginning of season two? It sort of was setting up how you transitioned from season one of the show to season two. And in addition to all the bits of backstory getting filled in, there had been a reference on the show to the fact that Queen Bee...
Right, she can exert her power, her influence over most men and some women. And that was a line from the show.
Yeah, and there had been a reference to the fact that she had been responsible in some fashion for the death of Marie Logan,
right.
Beast Boy's mother. And so we saw that scene happen in the comic. And there's a moment that it's Marie Logan and Queen Bee in Marie Logan's pickup truck at the top of this cliff. And the scripted thing was that she was going to influence Marie Logan into just driving that truck off the cliff. And in keeping with how Queen Bee's power works, she influences, puts people under her thrall by kissing them. And so there was a very non-sexual kiss between the two women in the script. And I was sort of anticipating that could be trouble.
The script got approved.
Yeah, the script got approved. So it comes to me, I'm like, they're letting us do this? Really? Awesome. Like, not
there no pictures come with it.
But you know, thinking it's like, I don't want to like, whatever line they're letting us walk up to, I didn't want the way I drew it to be what made it something that we weren't gonna get away with. I even dreaded that I drew like the moment before their lips touched. And there was nothing sexual in the facial expressions or anything. And I turned in the art, and we were told, no, you can't possibly do anything like that. Yeah. So.
By the way, and what really pissed me off
yeah.
is that in the very next scene, Queen Bee does the exact same thing to a guy, and had no problem with it whatsoever. So they were like, you have to change this page. I said, if we're changing this page, we're changing the second page as well.
That's why we love him. Yeah.
So Garrett was an established code from Gargoyles days, yes?
Yeah, in Gargoyles, kissing was a human custom. We were always in Gargoyles trying to do things to make the Gargoyles seem like their own species and not just you know, humans with wings. So the gargoyle sort of parallel custom was sort of stroking the brow or stroking the hair. So although that has nothing whatsoever to do with Young Justice, we're trying to come up with an easy fix to these two art pages that were already done.
Yeah.
And so we just decided it would be Queen Bee stroking first Marie's hair, and then guy's name was Ollie in the next page.
Yeah. And so basically, you know, I adjusted the art so that the two women were intimately close to each other, but instead of obviously going in for a kiss, it was a stroking of the hair. And that was the change we had to make. The change we chose to make was to have the scene with the male character change the same way, because we were going to have them be the same.
Yeah.
And I really didn't want to alter the original artwork, because I like the page, and Greg had expressed an email that, like, that was his favorite page from the whole series. And this was in our last issue of the book, and we knew it was the last issue of the book. And I already had it in the back of my mind that when the book wrapped, I wanted to find some kind of a gift for Greg. So I just made the changes to the panel digitally and gave the original unaltered page to Greg as our wrap gift.
Yeah, over here.
So this question's for everyone. Since we're at a Doctor Who convention, I'm curious if any of you are fans of the show, and if so, if you have a favorite Doctor or episode, and if not, if you could share what your conjecture or misimpressions of the show are.
I'm a big fan of the show. My son's over here, Benny. Woo! And I are in the process of watching every modern Doctor Who episode. My favorite is Eccleston. But I like—I haven't met a Doctor I haven't liked.
I don't know the show, unfortunately. But I assume it's about, like, a pediatrician from Whoville.
Yes. You're dead on.
Okay.
David Tennant, Weeping Angels. So not a fan.
You know, I haven't watched all of them. I've seen a few of them. My son, who's over here, has seen all of them. He's a David Tennant kind of guy, right?
Yeah.
I'm a fan of the show. I love the show. I love all things that hail from England. So, my entire house is a Union Jack. So, and I love all the Doctors. So, sorry. Lolita.
Richard Herndrell as the first Doctor in the Five Doctors.
That probably covers that.
Well, I will say, I just want to, Asylum of the Daleks stays with me. It's heartbreaking.
Yeah.
And it's just a tremendous, tremendous episode.
It's funny you should ask.
On a panel, talking TV.
One of three executive producers on a little show called Star Wars Rebels. Which will come out in the fall of this year. But for today, more importantly, I wrote a novel. Oh, he's got one. She's got one. Don't you all want one? You can get them from me for $10 in cash. Right here, right after the panel's over for about a half hour, and then we're going to the lobby, and I'll even sell them to you there, because really, I'll sell them to you anyway.
And you can't catch him today and look for his truck next to the highway.
So, I will sign it. For $10, you get a signed book, and while supplies last, I've got copies. This was developed as an animated series at DreamWorks over a decade ago. We never made it, but I have the original character designs from that. They're just Xeroxes, but they're still pretty cool. And art by Kuni Tamita. So that also comes for the $10, the art as well as the book. Yeah.
It's awesome. I got one.
That covers my commercial for the.
Well, I've been working on a little show I like to call Star Wars Rebels. And I wrote this book. I'm all over the place looking for work. I'm about to do a show, very similar show, called Ray Donovan. Just a couple episodes, no big deal, until they make me write it. Hang on.
Well, since there's three of us, I'll just mention one or two, and they can mention the next. We're really excited to be going to, at the end of South by Southwest, there's going to be an orchestra concert, and the opening number is going to be a big suite of our music from the series Justice League. I don't know if you guys watched it. Yeah, we're just so excited about that. And we're working on currently...
Looking for work. I forgot. We're actually working on Marvel's Avengers Assemble. We had been working on Young Justice, which ended. We had been working on Kaijudo, which ended. And Michael.
Well, that's quite a lot. And we also have a CD of Young Justice.
Which we will all sign.
Which we will all sign as well. After this whole thing is over with. So, if you're interested.
I just did a... online video game called Infinite Crisis where I got to play Robin as well. It's Robin. Tim Drake. However, they pretty
you
much
just typecasted the Tim Drake Robin.
I just look the part, I feel like. this one is a little bit more carefree, which is cool. It's cool to play someone who wasn't terrified of dying.
Tim Drake Rises, right? Yeah. You're like tucked away in your room.
Forget Red Hood. Red Beard.
Yeah, I'm just working on a lot of video games. I signed some stuff, so I can't say nothing. But it's good. It's good. Some stuff, it's good.
Yeah.
Well, you know. I'm working on a couple video games. I've also signed non-disclosures. The minute they go public, I'll be like dancing around. It's very cool stuff. And I also just got published. I'm also an aspiring writer. There's a woman here in Los Angeles. She produces a storytelling show called True Tales of Lust and Love. And they chose several performers who read their essays to be put and compiled into a book called True Tales of Lust and Love, which I don't have with me, but it is available on Amazon. Well, I'm not sure that I don't know that I really want you to read it, because it's a true story, but it's pretty apocalyptic, so good luck with that. It's filthy. Someone from college, I thought we were going to get married, and I came home to find that he had utilized the cat box. I know, okay? Great, that's what my big education will give you. Great.
Yeah. He was very resourceful.
Yeah. Anyway, if you're up for that kind of thing, good luck.
Trying to get away from the bad boys. This
is yours.
I just finished using the cat box. I did a series for Hasbro called Tag Judo that finished, and I had an episode of a reboot of the old show Thunderbirds Argo by a British company, and Weta, Peter Jackson's company. Did an episode of Ultimate Spider-Man and a Ninja Turtles, and I'm story editing for a series called Transformers Rescue Bots, Transformers Junior, also wearing a glove. Nicole left and she's currently story editing for a new Disney series. So.
I forget sometimes when I'm on a panel. I'm like, oh, really?
Yeah.
Sorry. Keep going.
So, that's what I'm doing.
Got it. Thanks. Okay, that would be me.
You.
Yeah, so I'm on Being Human on Monday, and I'm not wearing a lot of clothes. Woo! Yeah, I always lose my voice when I do those things because you scream a lot. I'm in a werewolf movie. Oh, that's a theme, not on purpose. Where it's called. It's not out yet. And everyone in my family dies but me. I'm not supposed to tell you that. what else? I don't know. Oh, I'm doing a pilot next week, but who knows what will happen. I've done a lot of those.
Okay.
I'm like 14 and still auditioning all the time. Yeah, I don't know, I have a web show called Playdate that I love. It's kind of old now, but it's still so cute. And it's on AOL. I have a kid, so I'm like really busy with that part of my life. And I would love to say I'm working on a little show called Star Wars Rebels. Next panel.
See, because I was going to say that.
Yeah. like
star-crossed lovers
or
something. You know, you hate me in the beginning. Yeah, like then we get together later because
yeah,
we're kind of like,
see
like
that
opposites.
Right.
Do you think you can help us out? I'm just saying it's something we might be able to do. Yeah, I would give anything to be on Star Wars Rebels. But I'm not sure. I play Justin Hammer on Avengers Assemble. In a bunch of video games that I also cannot talk about because they make you sign stuff, which is really awful because they're so great, especially like with motion capture and the things that, the technology that's out there now. I mean, I play a hunchback in one of them. I mean, there's just so much cool stuff. But unfortunately, it's lip sealed until they say you can say anything about it. So, I guess follow my Twitter feed because I will be announcing some of that stuff shortly.
Everybody on this panel is on Twitter except Michael and Eric.
We are on Twitter as Dynamic Music Partners.
I will be getting on Twitter. Everybody's pressuring me. I'm getting on. I just don't have.
It's
I mean,
so great.
I'm afraid of you guys. You guys are mean. Why are you talking about mean people on Twitter? I'm scared.
But we love you.
Oh, thank you.
I have never done any professional voice acting, but if I was going to start, I would want to be on Star Wars. Since Young Justice wrapped, I did a story for Batman 66. That was a lot of fun as I am a huge Adam West Batman series fan. Currently working on DVDs. Currently working on something new that nobody's heard of before. That's going to be called Parallel Man. There's nothing really out on that yet, but there will be in about a month. You're in the know, man. If you follow me on any social media, the internet of any kind, blogs, ChristopherJonesArt.com, I'll be announcing it all the heck over the place in about a month.
Yeah. Time for maybe one or two more. Yeah, right here.
Awesome. For the actors, it's a two-part but simple question. What was your favorite line or scene to do, and what line or scene do the fans ask for the most often? Well, I thought it was simple.
Okay, what is the
name? Assuming actors have memories.
What show was that? My favorite scene to do was the one where
I'm nervous.
Art? No. Well,
New Year's Eve.
Yeah, I guess that would have to be. Okay, I'll tell the story. So I was reading the episode where it's New Year's Eve and Wally and Artemis have their first kiss.
Everybody was doing it. Leave it there.
Right? It's like how it's not like an excuse. And as an actor, you read that kind of thing, and you're typically doing voiceover, so we make up things to make it sound realistic. Like a lot of times you'll kiss your hand, or you know, to make that snap, that kiss, because there's something audibly about it that is very intimate, that also allows you to connect with the characters. There's an audio sensation about a kiss. And typically that's what you do. Since we had a chance to work, usually several of us together. Greg and Brandon wanted to make sure that the experience was authentic as possible. So, right? And probably just you. And so we're preparing for that scene, and we're all in a row, and we're reading it and everything. By myself. And then we're prepping, you know, reading through it, getting ready, and then Greg says, "Okay, Jason, I want you to go over to Stephanie's mic."
Jane.
Said, "Go over to Stephanie's mic." And I'm like, "Oh, okay, cool," because they want us to kind of do an actor thing where we're close together, you know, to get that sort of sense of it. No problem, okay, fine. So I go over next to each other, and we're and she smiles, and I'm like, "Okay, here we go." And we go through the scene. And they go, "Okay, now, go ahead." I kid you not, Stephanie goes, "Go ahead, what?" go where? And he goes, "Okay, well, you're supposed to kiss, you know?" And I'm like, we both turn into like sixth graders.
That's like,
which is exactly what happens in sixth grade. And guys are like, "Yeah," girls are like, "Okay, whatever." And so we do the kiss, and I thought it was pretty good.
Absolutely, everyone was doing it.
Yeah.
Can I say that?
Sure.
And so everybody
sure.
passed gum around, whatever, and all. Yeah.
And then
it's being recorded.
I thought, like, in the interest of professionalism.
Yeah. On camera, you've never had to kiss an actor. You weren't
we,
actually
Yeah,
married.
But you're prepared mentally.
First,
that moment, I was just so
First of all,
thrilled.
I want everyone here to know I was incredibly professional, okay?
Yeah.
So professional, in fact, I was like, "Hey, do you think we could get another take?" Because I don't think that one was quite where we needed to be. So, you can tell your version of the story, but I have to say...
So anyway, that's his favorite.
That's my favorite moment. And the one
question.
That the fans ask me for the most is... They probably don't want to talk about it, but what they say the most is, "I can't believe you died."
Yeah.
Right? Because you don't ever see a lead character disappear at the end of a series. And that was... I'll try to stay brief about that. When I first read the script, I cried, and I couldn't believe that you got left, Artemis got left with that heartache.
So sad.
And Greg and Brandon actually came up and apologized to me. Brandon came up and apologized to me. When I showed up, he said, "I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that we killed you." And I said, no. This is something fantastic, because as an actor, you don't ever get to be immortalized like that as a cartoon character. You never really die. You don't really get to have that happen unless you're, you know, a one-off or whatever as a lead character. It was a tremendous honor to think that they wanted the story to end with that level of envelope pushing, like you had mentioned before. So it was really a pleasure. Thanks for doing that.
Yeah!
So... There were so many things that I loved.
One thing I'll say, it's not really a favorite line.
I think that was Spitfire Cam.
I will say this, I'm still friends with Danica and Lacey, who played my girlfriends on the show. And I feel really grateful for that. Grateful to Young Justice for that. We had so many scenes where we're playing friends and where we're having an aside, and we really were girls in a room full of guys a lot of time having, you know, those moments in real life. And so I'm really forever thankful because they're my friends in real life right now. And Danica, you know, was pregnant when we were doing that, and then I was right after, and so there was just a lot of bonding that happened, and I'm not sure if there's a favorite line, but I love doing that episode with Satana where it was like, what was it? Not Halloween, but that scary dude.
It was
like
harm.
Yeah, it was so horrifying.
Secret.
And the little kid. It was Halloween, yeah.
Yes,
secrets.
Yeah.
Like, it was so. I mean, I love so many things, so I'm trying to think what was my absolute favorite. And I fully cried and mourned him. And, oh, I know what my favorite was, though. Hi. They brought my actual dog into a scene. For me, that was the coolest. And when I even got to, you know, have a say in the art and help have him really look like my dog. And I mean, I full on cried in a weird way when you told me at first, and then I thought I scared them and they won't really do it. And I'm like, no, I'm really happy I said that. So I don't know what the fans, I mean, is there something that you have a favorite thing? I'm not sure.
Care
don't really care about this character. Got it. Moving on.
I really love the first scene where Black Canary meets her students. And no one's ever asked me for a Black Canary line. I only get requested for the Mary Jane line.
Not for Ida?
Woo! No. Not for Ida. Isn't that awful? Yeah, that was tragedy. But I enjoyed singing the Megan song. Yes, that was awesome. Kevin Michael Richardson killed it. We had so much fun. You don't often get to do that in a cartoon. Well, sometimes for like Batman and some other things, but that was hilarious. I love that.
My favorite episode was I'm not sure what the number was or the title, but it was when Blue Beetle kind of turned bad. He was kind of like back and forth. He was in front of the camera. He's like, I'm Blue Beetle.
Well, someone was like, you know, controlling your
He was controlling him, but it was just really cool to get to jump back and forth like that. And and any line, like any scene with like the back and forth with the Scarab and Hyman was just really, really fun and really well written. And as far as, I didn't get any requests from fans, but at the last panel I did, I had a lot of people saying that, oh, I didn't even care about Blue Beetle until this show, and like, and hearing you voice them, it's like, so that was a huge compliment. So that was great. That's always really nice to hear.
I also liked that episode, I'm going to mention, because that was the first time I got to play two characters in one episode. I got to play Robin, and I got to play Toy Man. And I also liked the first episode because I had a lot to do. No. I ran Gamma.
That's me. Oh. well, as you know, I only did one episode, and every word of it was genius. Yeah. That's why I'm on Star Wars. Greg had written something that wound up on my Twitter feed about how there was a potential of possibly having done a musical episode of Gargoyles because there were a lot of singing people on the show. I don't know if you saw this, but a couple of people went on to say how bad I was on the show and how bad my performance was. So you don't know what you're missing, really. But, you know, I was just happy to be on the show, and to play the Joker was a thrill. And I assume if there'd been another season, I would have been.
We had more plans for Joker.
Yeah, good, thanks.
And I thought you were brilliant as Joker, by the way. I thought you were amazing.
All right, so it's after 6 o'clock. Thank you so much for attending the Q&A. A few of us are going to hang out, not necessarily everyone, so anyone who wants to take off, you can. But some of us, like I said, you know, these guys and me, we have stuff to sell you. So a few of us are going to hang out, we'll sign stuff. So what I'd like is anyone who's interested in either getting signatures or purchasing, line up on this wall and we'll just sort of go around this way for anyone who wants to stay, anyone who wants to take off. Now's your moment to get out while the getting's good.